So basically, we are going to discuss here Bernoulli's principle. Write down. Bernoulli's principle. Fine. So now, before we get down to the mathematics of the Bernoulli's principle, let us discuss few things about it first. Okay. So we have a work energy theorem when we talk about the solids. Okay. Similar to work energy theorem, as in the same concept of conserving energy, we can somehow use it in the case of fluid also. Okay. But the thing is that right now, the way we know work energy theorem, that is work done is equal to change in potential energy plus change in kinetic energy, it is not very comfortable to use the formula of work energy theorem as it is in the case of fluid when it is flowing. All right. Hence, we need to modify the work energy theorem so as to make it suitable to use it for the fluids. All right. Now, when you write in for the fluids, you need to use terms like pressure, terms like density, right? So in terms of these, I want my work energy theorem for the fluid flow. Okay. So this is what we are going to do over here. All right. Now, when we apply basically work energy theorem for the Bernoulli's principle, there are certain assumptions also. Okay, so first we'll list down all the things related to it. So write down, Bernoulli's principle is nothing but application of work energy theorem on streamline flow. Okay, there are other assumptions also, we'll discuss it. So basically, we need to modify work energy theorem so as to make it comfortable to use for fluids. Okay. And when we talk about fluids, basically I want to basically use work energy theorem in terms of what are the terms I should need? Pressure, density, you can use velocity of it and the height. Okay. So basically, instead of force, I want pressure in the equation. Instead of mass, I want density in the equation. Fine. So that is the thing that we have to do here. Now the assumptions, write down. These are very important. Before you apply Bernoulli's theorem, you need to make sure that these things are valid for that flow. So the first assumption is that it is a streamlined flow. Okay. It's a streamlined flow. Okay. Second is that it is a non-viscous flow. I'm sure you guys have a little bit idea about the viscosity. So basically, when one laminar or one layer of the fluid move on the other layer of the fluid, if they move relative to each other, you can say it is like a friction between the two layers. So if viscous flow is there, so there is a chance that some mechanical energy gets converted into heat So the energy loss has happened. So if energy loss happens, you can't account it, in a work energy theorem the way we know it. Fine. So you need to include only mechanical energy. You can't account for the thermal losses, right? So you need to make sure that it is a non-viscous flow, or at least no frictional losses are there. Fine. Then incompressible flow, write down. Now, why incompressible flow? As in, we have derived it like that. Okay, you'll see the derivation, then you will understand. Okay, and then it should not be rotational flow. Okay, so irrotational flow. What's a rotational flow? Tornado, you might have seen in the movies. Okay, it rotates like that. So this kind of flow is not included for the Bernoulli's theorem because there are losses in those kind of flow also. Fine. So these assumptions we have to keep in our mind. And now let us see how we can derive the Bernoulli's principle. Okay. So this is a very popular, thing which is asked, at least in your school exam, lot of teachers, they ask this. Okay, pay attention for your school also, it is very important. So what I am going to do is I am going to consider a section of a pipe. Fine. So all of you draw with me. It's a part of a bigger pipe. Fine. So the pipe goes on like this. It's a part of a bigger pipe. Fine. Now, the parameters which are known to us, right? For example, area of cross section A1 is known. Area of cross section A2 is known. The velocity over here, it is known. V1, velocity over there, it is known as V2. Okay. Now, when you write the mechanical energy, let's talk about the potential energy. What is the first thing you do? You take a level, a horizontal level, and then say that is my zero potential energy, right? So we need to define that over here also. So let us say that this horizontal line represents zero gravitational potential energy. Okay. And the heights should be given so that we can write the potential energy terms. So these are the two heights that are given to us. Fine. This is, let's say, height H2 and this is height H1. All right. And the pressure over here, pressure inside the pipe over here is P2. Pressure inside the pipe over there is P2. Over here P1, over there it is P2. Okay. All of you understand this? Any question in the scenario which we have taken? Quickly type in. Okay, clear? Fine. Now, do you remember how we have used work energy theorem in case of solids? What do? We take two points. We take two points and apply work energy theorem between the two points, right? These two points are two points in time or two points in space. What I'm trying to say is that you are using work energy theorem between what is happening right now and what is going to happen later. Is that the case? Or you are applying work energy theorem for the same time between two places? Do you understand what I'm trying to ask here, all of you? Can you answer? Different times, right? Different times. What we do is that we find out what is the what is happening right now, and then what will happen later on, and use Working theorem between these two points in time. Isn't it? For example, a ball is moving down the inclined plane. So right now it is at the top. Later on it comes at the bottom, and you have to find, let's say, velocity over there, right? So you use two points in time. Okay, so remember that. Okay, so I'll write here. What we do is that we apply work energy theorem between what is happening right now and what will happen later. Okay, yeah, hold on for some time. Now tell me, when we apply the work energy theorem, okay, when we apply the work energy theorem, the first thing what we do, we select our mass on which I am applying work energy theorem, right? So where is that mass over here on which you are applying work energy theorem, all of you? On which mass I am applying work energy theorem? The fluid, entire fluid, or a particle of the fluid? What it is? Okay. Entire fluid, as in the big pipe, entire pipe, or only the pipe which is shown to you? Okay. Pipe shown to, see, yeah, only the shown part, right? So yeah, you can apply work energy theorem for a particle also, no problem with it. But the way we have derived the Bernoulli's theorem, our system is the fluid inside this pipe, inside this yellow pipe, which is shown here. This is a section of a bigger pipe, and my system is this. I'm going to study this. What happens to it, right? What is happening right now? The fluid inside it, and what will happen later on? The fluid that is inside it. Okay, so right now this is what is happening. This is the snapshot right now. Later on, what will happen? Later on, some fluid will go inside, let us say, from this side. Okay, and some fluid will go out from this side, like that. Okay, now I'm going to ask you something very, very important. This is, let's say, this part is zone 1, Z1. This part is, let's say, zone 2. And this part is, let's say, zone 3. Okay, so your mass on which you are applying work energy theorem, initially was what? Z1 plus Z2, Z2 plus Z3, or Z1 plus Z3? Where was your entire mass initially? At t equal to 0, your mass was what? Z1 plus Z2, all of you agree? Z1 plus Z2, right? Entire fluid inside it, that was your t equal to 0, right? After a small time interval dt, at t equal to delta t, let's say, where your mass went, now what is your system? Your system become what? Z1 plus Z2, Z2 plus Z3, or what? Yes, good. So Z2 plus Z3. All right, so keep in your mind. All right, keep in your mind that initially my system was inside Z1, Z2, zone 1, zone 2. After delta T, my system shifts and it has become now Z2 plus Z3 because I have to trace where my mass went, right? When we apply Work-Energy theorem. Okay, great. Now the way we know Work-Energy theorem, we'll write it as it is. Okay, so Work-Energy theorem says that W is equal to U2 minus U1 plus K2 minus K1. Do you all understand this, everyone? Okay, let's say this distance is delta x1, okay, and this distance, let's say that one is delta x2. Fine. So first I'll find out the work done. Tell me how much is the work done when my system, which was z1 plus z2, became z2 plus z3. What is the work done by the external force other than gravity on my system? What is the external force? Tell me, external force is what apart from gravity? There is this pressure over here which will create force, and pressure over there that will create the force. So how much is the work done by these forces? By force into displacement is the work done, isn't it? Keep it simple. The force is P1A1. Okay, displacement is delta x1. Work done will be positive or not? This side, left hand side, work done is positive or should I add negative here? Everyone, force into displacement, positive or negative work done? Positive. What about over here? What is the work done by P2? What's the work done by P2? Quickly type in work done by P2 is what? I'm not asking positive, negative. Tell me the value, how much? Okay, people are saying positive work done P2 A2 delta X2. Is it correct? Is the work done positive or negative? It is negative, guys. Pressure will push it from this side like that. Right, pressure will try to compress, isn't it? So it is a negative work. Force is this way, displacement that way. So displacement is away from the force. So that's why work done is negative. And this is the total work done. Okay. Now comes the potential energy. I'll first write down the initial potential energy. Okay. So potential energy initially is Z1 plus Z2. So potential energy of Z1. Plus potential energy of Z2. Okay, what is the potential energy of Z1? It's a small zone over here. How much it is? Tell me, in terms of density, you can write rho. This is my zero gravitational potential energy. Ug is zero. What is the mass of this? This portion's mass is how much? Rho A1 delta X1, correct. So rho A1 delta X1, this is mass mg into H1, right? mgh1, all of you agree? Plus potential energy of Z2. Why I am not writing potential energy of Z2? Why I am not expanding it? I'm keeping it like that only. Anyone? Because it is going to get cancelled, right? U2 is what? Similarly, tell me U2. U2 is potential energy of Z2 plus potential you have Z3. You can see at t equal to delta t, Z2 plus Z3 it has become. So what it is? U2 is potential energy of Z2 plus rho A2 delta X2 G H2. This is my U2. Getting it? Now tell me what is my K1? Kinetic energy of zone Z1 plus kinetic energy of zone Z2. This is my K1. How much it is equal to? Half mv square is kinetic energy. Use that. Keep it simple. What should I write? Zone Z1's kinetic energy half rho A1 delta X1. This is mass into V square plus kinetic energy of zone Z2. This is initial kinetic energy, right? Final kinetic energy is what? Kinetic energy of zone Z2 plus kinetic energy of zone Z3. This is equal to KZ2 plus half rho A2 delta X2 V2 square. This was V1 square. Everybody understood till now? All of you have understood what is W. We have found out. We have found out U1, U2, K1, K2. Everybody understood? All of you, type in quick. Now tell me, is the volume of Z1, volume of Z1, is it equal to volume of Z3 or not? Whatever volume of liquid goes in equals to same volume of liquid goes out. That is a continuity equation, isn't it? So I can say that, I can say A1 delta X1 is equal to A2 delta X2. It comes from A1 V1 is equal to A2 V2. V1 is delta X1 by delta T. So delta T get cancelled away. So A1 delta X1 is equal to A2 delta X2. Now I want you to substitute the value of W, U1, U2, K1, K2 over here. Use this continuity equation to simplify and tell me what you get. Okay, quickly do it your own. Quick. So once you substitute it, you're going to get this. P1 plus half rho V1 square plus rho GH1 is equal to P2 plus half rho V2 square plus rho GH2. All right. So this is the modified form of work energy theorem suitable for the flow kind of scenario. Okay. I hope everybody understood over here. So let us, understand what are these terms imply. So clearly, you know, when you look at half rho V square, you like, oh, this looks like kinetic energy. Rho GH, you look like, you know, potential energy. Fine. So basically you're adding all the energies of point one and equating it to energies of point two. Do you all see that? All the energies of point one, in a way, you have equated it to energies of point number two. So basically, you know, when we talk about half rho V square, it is nothing but kinetic energy per unit volume. Rho is m by v, mass divided by volume, right? So this is kinetic energy per unit volume, or you can say density of kinetic energy. Density of kinetic energy. Okay, then the second term, the third term, rho gh. This is the gravitational potential energy per unit volume, which is nothing but density of the potential energy. All right, then you have P. Okay, P is a new kind of energy, which is pressure energy per unit volume. Okay, pressure energy per unit volume. So this is density of the pressure energy. All right, so you are nothing but what you are doing is equating the density of the energies on the left hand side to the density of the energy on the right hand side. So that's another reason why liquid should not be compressible. If liquid compresses, density increases. So you can't equate the density of the energies, right? So P1 plus half rho V1 square plus rho GH is nothing but density of the total energy. Okay, and one more thing, if you can understand properly over here, that when we are applying work energy theorem for the flow kind of scenario, we are applying 2 points in space, not 2 points in time. Look at the expression. P1 half rho V1 square rho GH1, P2 half rho V2 square plus rho GH2. Everything is happening right now. Right now, whatever is happening at point number one, you're equating it to right now, whatever happens at point number two. Okay. So work energy theorem for a flow kind of scenario, you're applying it in 2 points in space at the same time. Okay. All right. Few more things. Talking about how you can utilize Bernoulli's theorem to basically solve questions. First of all, there has to be a flow. Okay. It has to be laminar, non-viscous, incompressible, irrotational flow. Okay. If all those things are happening, then what you do is that since it is a streamlined flow, we need to first draw a streamline then pick 2 points on it to apply Bernoulli's theorem. This should be very clear. Fine. And one more thing you need to understand over here is that H1, H2, they are heights. Okay. They are height. Why I'm emphasizing that? Because you know, H comes in this kind of expression also. Variation of pressure with height or depth. PA plus rho GH. This H is measured from the top. This H is measured from the depth, sorry, from the bottom. Okay, so when you use Bernoulli's theorem, you have to use H just like potential energy. When you're finding the pressure, this H is depth. Okay, so depth and height are two different things. Okay, suppose this is you, the height of your head is this from the bottom, the depth of your head is zero, it is right at the top only. Okay, depth of your head is zero, but height is maximum. So I hope you got it. All right. Fine. So this is the Bernoulli's theorem discussion. All right.